Hi, everybody. I'm so happy to be here. I'm here to talk about music and the future of music and the music of the future. And as you've heard, I am interested in these subjects because I split my time between two quite different careers. On one side, I'm a writer and an editor. I, at Motherboard, edit a science fiction magazine called Terraform, where we publish stories, speculative fiction stories weekly, which have some bearing on the present day because we believe that science fiction is a critical lens for understanding the world. But I'm also, my day job is that I'm a musician. I play music in this band called YACHT, which is a band that has been around for 15 years. As a musician, I deal in the present, in the ephemeral quality of the medium itself, and the nowness of a live show, which always brings you back to the present moment. But as a writer, I deal with the future, or futures, rather. Dystopian, utopian, retro, post-lapsarian, you name it. I find it all fascinating. All the places where tomorrow impinges on today. All of this is to say, I think, that I am in a fairly good position to consider how the future of music will unfold, how music will change in the coming years over time, and to try to extrapolate, as a science fiction writer would, from the known conditions of our experience into a distant tomorrow that we may not live to see or hear. I am biased to believe that music is a kind of universal. I've experienced firsthand the way that it can transcend language and connect with people around the world. But as a writer, as somebody whose lifeblood is impinging on the experience of being able to zoom out from the Google map of my own reality, I find it hard to believe that anything can be universal. And yet the notion that music, like mathematics or code, is a universal language is something that's very sticky, and not without reason. It has some basis in science. The human brain hums with complex rhythms as synapses send signals from neuron to neuron, and we're just beginning to learn that these rhythms have a hand in all manner of cognitive functions, from motor control, perception, and memory. And music affects us on the limbic system level, which is a relatively ancient part of the human brain, and one which we share with much of the animal kingdom. But my question today, one of many, is what about life beyond Earth? We have this idea that music is a kind of universal language. It's an idea that comes from science fiction movies, like, for example, Close Encounters of the Third Kind. When the alien ships in this film descend on the Earth, they communicate using a melody. And that five-note melody is communicated back to them using an ARP 2500 synthesizer. This is a melody which establishes not only contact, but goodwill. The synthesizer literally synthesizes, bridging a cosmic gulf between two very different intelligences. And this belief isn't isolated to fiction necessarily. Consider the NASA Golden Record, of course, a disc of a human mixtape, if you will, for the sounds of Earth that was tacked to the Voyager 1 and 2 probes in 1977. It contains everything from Bach to whale sounds and Chuck Berry. Connected to the Voyager probes and sent into space in 1977, the same year as Close Encounters, the Golden Record is now the farthest man-made musical object from Earth. It is 20 billion kilometers away as of this afternoon, far beyond our solar system. Of course, it's likely that aliens would take the Golden Record as a piece of space garbage. Even Carl Sagan, who orchestrated the project, he called it a symbolic statement rather than a serious attempt to communicate with extraterrestrial life. And of course, he's right. The idea that music might be a tool for communicating with aliens is predicated on far too many false assumptions to be true. Chief among them is the assumption that aliens would have evolved along the same lines as us, with the same sensory apparatus for translating frequencies into meaning. And the factors propagating sound from planet to planet would vary, which makes audition an unlikely universal. And there's no evidence that evolution on a parallel scale is possible, except for the diversity of ears and eyeballs on Earth. But even on our own planet, living beings experience sound in a staggering diversity of ways. Elephants hear with their giant ears, but reptiles sense vibration through the ground with their bodies. Bats, of course, echolocate in the blind, and whales call to each other with moans and clicks across the sea. Incidentally, whale sounds are included on the golden record, which means that perhaps that will be the language of the distant future. If extraterrestrials, by some crazy chance, do experience sound, then we are still left with the problem of aesthetics and meaning. Perhaps Bach would offend the palate of a far more foreign intelligence, or perhaps something far more sinister.
What's killing him? I think it must be my music.
If aliens are interested in us, which is already an assumption, they have plenty of material already. We have been leaking radio transmissions into space since the dawn of communications in the modern age, and this garble of information could tell a lot more about us to alien species than we might perhaps be comfortable with, just as a full perusal of your unedited search history reveals a very clear sense of your personhood, to say nothing of the limits of your intelligence. The result of that is not necessarily flattering. In Carl Sagan's science fiction novel Contact, which was of course made into a film in 1997, aliens from the Vega star system make contact with Earth by sending back the first signal strong enough to escape our planet's ionosphere. That signal is, of course, Adolf Hitler's opening speech from the Berlin Olympics in 1936. It's embarrassing, but not unpredictable. An intentional message, like the Golden Record, would still travel through the universe through millennia, and we might not be around by the time our message reaches its unintended audience. And if so, we may not be taking a form that anyone here would recognize. And so the function of an object, like the Golden Record, might transform from message to time capsule to tombstone. When it comes to these issues, I sometimes think of the artist Trevor Paglen, who in 2012 created a more realistic, although equally subjective, version of the Golden Record by etching onto a silicon disc images of human joy and suffering. Images, for example, like the vision of a drone or the suffering of refugees, and sent it into space with a satellite in 2012. In geosynchronous orbit, some 36,000 kilometers above sea level, a satellite can hang undisturbed for millennia. This is a sweet spot for time capsules in the darkness of deep time. I interviewed Paglen once about this project, and he said to me that at some point, there will be no evidence of human civilization on Earth, but there will be a collection of dead spacecraft from an ancient civilization in Earth's orbit. That's us. For any archaeologists who might come along before our sun turns into a red giant, these dead spacecraft will be like the blocks of Stonehenge or the pyramids of Giza. They will be monolithic records of the distant human past. In science fiction, we call this a big dumb object, like the Ringworld or the monolith from 2001. If there is music here, how can it be anything but an elegy? And on the rare chance that we haven't destroyed ourselves and everything else along with it, we will certainly have made evolutionary leaps forward in the composition and understanding of music. Consider the difference between Incan pan flutes and Frank Zappa, for example. And that's only 1,000 years of relatively eventless human history. Which leads us to my first question today. Is it possible to future-proof music, to make a sound which not only outlives our generation, but stands to represent humanity, the fact that we existed at all, to the mute audience of the cosmos? The simplest answer to this question is no. If you look at the only place where this question is regularly posed, again, science fiction, any attempt that we have made to create futuristic music has always fallen short. From the Mos Eisley Cantina in Star Wars to the cave rave from The Matrix Reloaded, it's never futuristic. Because, like all science fiction, It reveals much more about its present than our future. For example, musical trends are ephemeral. They have a very short half-life. Archaeologists of the future would be able to carbon date the precise date of release of a science fiction music just by looking at it. For example, there's no question that what you're about to see is from a late 60s Star Trek episode.
I'm talking about you. I'm talking about me. Long time back when the galaxy was new, man found out what he had to do. Found he had to eat, and he found he had to drink. And a long time later, he found he had to think.
Amazing, right? This is the late 60s. I mean, it's musical subcultures, it's aesthetic mores, it's social values really trapped in amber. But since we are engaged in a thought experiment, the first of many today, I hope, let us consider the question, what does futuristic, future-proof, eternal music sound like? It can't contain language, of course, because language changes too quickly from place to place, from culture to subculture. It can't be rhythmic, because our sense of rhythm is conditioned to our heartbeat and a sense of time indigenous to our planet. Can it even be beautiful? Or is beauty something too closely wired to our neurochemistry, to the resonances and tones that soothe our brains and summon stored subjective memories to awareness, even when performed by an alien? The beauty of an aria lives in its listener. It is dependent on the sensations that the melody evokes, the memories it stirs within each individual, dependent on personal history, state of mind, experiences, heartbreak, fear. This is true for all art, which lives in a place between the creator and the audience. It is a command that ignites feelings locked in the receiver. Half meaningless until received. There's going to be a quiz after this for all the movies. You have to name them all. Beginning with Pythagoras, ancient thinkers often wrote of a musica universalis, or music of the spheres, this idea that the relationships between planets in the universe and the solar system might have a form of music to them that is inaudible but mathematical, harmonic, even spiritual. The concept underlies Kepler's writing about planetary bodies. And Plato wrote about music and astronomy as two twinned studies of sensual recognition. Astronomy for the eyes and music for the ears. A little known byproduct of the NASA Voyager mission I mentioned earlier is a series of field recordings of the interaction between the solar wind and the magnetosphere of various planets in the solar system. NASA actually released this as a 5-disc album called Symphonies of the Planets, which is what you're hearing right now. That we call this music is a bit of a stretch. Really, it's just data in the form of sound. Although it does have the quality, a little bit of ambient drone. One way to future-proof music, I would suggest, would be to create single tones generated precisely by machine. Eternal music might just be a representation of the fact that we have the capacity to perceive and the intelligence to recreate discrete slices of the resonant spectrum. Of course, like the symphonies of the planets, the only thing separating this from just pure mathematics, physics, would be the engine that we use to perceive it through the ears rather than the eyes or the brain. This would make it a catch-22 because it would be the antithesis of music as we normally experience it. It would contain no emotional information, and it would not be pleasing to listen to. As in any fine art, music is defined by its subjective qualities. What counts cannot be counted. And yet, the idea that objective music somehow represents the future is very common and hangs around in our perceptions of it, again through science fiction, through the shorthand of electronic music, which has always served to represent the future in film. Sci-fi soundtracks like this, the Forbidden Planet soundtrack, the first ever entirely electronic film score, or Wendy Carlos's famous Switched on Bach from Clockwork Orange. These are dominated by synthesized tones, by electronic tones. And it's no coincidence that Steven Spielberg, when choosing a language to communicate with aliens in the Close Encounters film, would choose the language of a synthesizer. Because can you imagine an alien walking down from its ship playing a guitar? It's possible, but it's not common in the science fiction that we make, and there's a reason why Spock's Vulcan lute has always seemed so ridiculous. Because analog instruments are in a perpetual journey towards entropy, and they are too likely to generate tones which shade into one another, which are deeply ambiguous. They're not precise, and in our imagination of the future, things are either complete chaos or complete precision, right? A future in which things have been marged, pushed into perfect clarity. All this being said, I do believe that the music of the future will be electronic, but not because electronic music has a more clear relationship to the future, a more one-to-one relationship with sound input, or because the future has no space for ambiguity. The future has plenty of space for ambiguity, as I hope we will learn today. No, I believe the future of music will be electronic because I believe the ears of the future will not be entirely human. I have so far ignored the other intelligence with which we might communicate using a universal language like music. Not the minds belonging to aliens we will likely never meet, but those belonging to the artificial intelligences we are already creating. It's reasonable to believe that artificial intelligence will soon outpace our own. And even if we're not ready for it, plenty of people, very intelligent people, are already actively developing for this future. In our lifetimes, we will see the blossoming of artificial intelligence, whose drives and abilities will outpace our own, likely breaking past the boundaries of biological limitation. It's even possible they will develop self-awareness, or a process indistinguishable from self-awareness, which is the same thing. Artificial intelligence will be in many ways indistinguishable from our own. For one, with the advent of nanotechnology and other forms of cybernetic enhancement, it may become quite difficult to objectively place the line between human and machine. And we are, after all, already cyborgs, sheltering our dreams and desires in the cloud and in external devices. But AI is also destined to resemble its makers. It will be trained and is being trained like a child on everything we know to be true, with processes that model the way that we learn, the way that we think. As we move towards synthesis with machines, extending the range of our senses and altering the fundamental quality of our minds, it's certain that our tastes will change, that our media will change, is already changing. Perhaps we might develop a taste for the music made by machines. Why not? After all, the artificial intelligences of our relatively near future will have education that is rooted in the cultural products of humankind. And it will share DNA, the same hardware, languages, and algorithms with electronic music. It will have a networked relationship with devices and sounds capable of generating sound. And with minds operating at quantum speeds, it will have infinite relative time for musical endeavor. And of course, separated from our biological limitations, it will certainly be capable of playing expertly. It may not even need to play at all. After all, it used to take a needle, a laser, or a magnet to generate sound, but now all it takes is code. Machines have been able to sing for a long time. The song Daisy Bell, which was made famous in 2001, A Space Odyssey, by being the song that the HAL 9000 sings as it's being decommissioned, was actually performed for the first time in 1961 on an IBM 704, the first computer to sing, in a demonstration of Bell Labs' speech synthesis. Whether this performance is charming or sinister is entirely subjective, but it's worth noting that IBM is only one letter away from HAL, transposed. This performance marked the beginning of computers and machines in the musical canon. What you're hearing now is widely considered to be the first piece of music composed entirely by an electronic computer. It was written by a compositional language called Musicomp in 1956. This piece, which is performed by humans from notation, is called the Iliac Suite, and it's named after the computer, 10 feet deep, 2 feet wide, and 8.5 feet tall, which ran the program. Lejaron Hiller, who wrote the Musicomp code, went on to oversee many other computer and algorithmic music products and collaborate, among others, with John Cage. John Cage employed many random processes in his music, often without computers, but still algorithmic music. In a piece called Reunion, for example, he equipped a chessboard with a set of photoreceptors. The player's moves triggered sounds, which meant the composition was different every time it was played. And significant to our earlier evocation of the musica universalis, Cage also delegated his process to cosmic phenomena, as in this, the Atlas Ellipticalis, 1961, which was composed by laying a sheet of score paper on top of an astronomical chart and simply placing the notes where the stars occurred. Today, machines can perform at much higher caliber than the IBM 704 or the HAL 9000, for that matter. On one end of the spectrum, and I'm sure many of you are already familiar with this, we have the Japanese holographic pop icon, Hatsune Miku, with her synthetic voice, performing for audiences in the thousands. Miku's songs are written for her by her fans on a piece of software called the Vocaloid 2, designed by Yamaha. Her avatar belongs to a technology company called, I'm not kidding, Krypton Future Media. But the songs, illustrations, and videos that make up her identity are actually collectively authored by her millions of fans. On the other end of the spectrum, there are pieces of software designed to aid in the composition of original music, like this piano sonata that you're hearing now. This was written by Emily Heller, an updated version of the computer scientist and musician David Cope's Experiments in Musical Intelligence, or EMI. EMI was a program which pulled rules from the history of music and spit out new music in the style of canonized composers. So for example, if you gave EMI some Mahler, she would give you a composition that sounded like it was ripped from the music stands of 19th century Vienna. EMI famously wrote Mozart's 42nd Symphony. And her successor, Emily Howell, composes in an amalgam of style based on EMI's data, using a sense of taste instilled in her by her maker. EMI and Emily Howell's successes hinge on a kind of Turing test for musical appreciation. The more indistinguishable their compositions are from human compositions, the better, or the more blasphemous, because both EMI and Emily Heller ignited a great deal of controversy in the world of music studies. People thought it was baseless. Emily Howell is actually a few decades old now, and the field of algorithmic composition is developing faster than I can fully even account for here. Last year, Google Brain announced a new research group called Magenta, devoted entirely to the question of algorithmic music and art. And by training algorithms on recurrent neural networks with an input of millions of MIDI notes, essentially the sum total of human music, Magenta is creating AI tools for musicians. And they believe, as I do, that AI could be like the electric guitar for future generations of musicians. So far, these tools are highly competent at responding to melodies, like a kind of musical autocorrect or a partner in a duet. But they fall short when it comes to composing, generating longer melodies that actually hold together as songs with an underlying structure of, let's say, like a pop song verse, chorus, verse, bridge, etc. Without long-term structure, these algorithmic melodies wander at random. They're interesting, but they're unable to really satisfy us with a sense of resolution. Such music exists only in a persistent present, unable to look very far behind or ahead of itself, and see itself as part of a whole. This, of course, is a defining characteristic of human music and art, its relation to wholeness, to context. For an AI to create something that is recognizable as a song, it still needs a lot of human hand-holding. Humans must intervene with decision-making processes and structure, making the state of the art in algorithmic music, now as it ever has been, a matter of intense collaboration between human and machine. Inroads, of course, are being made towards resolving this using long short-term or LSTM neural networks. We're still a long way away from algorithms capable of composing entire songs, but there's no doubt that we are be there soon. These hurdles will be overcome before we know it. This lack of ability to recognize context, as well as a number of other factors, gives AI-generated music and AI-generated art its specific aesthetic flavor, what I like to call the computer accent. We still tend to perceive the computer accent as a kind of failure, because algorithms make suggestions that are not entirely right by our standards, making unusual mistakes that humans wouldn't make. They require constant refinement. But the computer accent is not long for this world. I'm sure it'll only be a short time before everything is indistinguishable from everything else. And I believe that we will miss it. I even believe that we will emulate it someday. Just like artists today borrow the filter effects of old school VHS cameras and analog recording equipment in order to convey a kind of authenticity, I believe that artists in the future will look to the specific aesthetic strangeness of the computer accent and its algorithmic failures as a way of registering an authentic voice. That's because the computer accent reveals something about how algorithms see the world and what they hear when we play them our music. And that is what art is all about, isn't it? An artist molds their worldview so that it can be beheld at a distance and by some time by other people. And this gesture, I believe, grows much more valuable with age. Art is like an injection of pigment into the bloodstream. It stains the present into history. And the faster we move, the closer we approach a kind of singularity, even if you don't believe in that, the more essential each incremental marker along the way becomes. Currently, much of the development of algorithmic music is in this area of recurrent neural networks, trained on a rich storehouse of human input. Fed millions of MIDI notes, an algorithm infers how to hear and understand and emulate our music. What emerges from this process reflects our biases about what art is, which is predicated on our sensory experience, the ears and eyes and touch that computers do not yet have. I think it's almost exquisitely myopic to judge post-human art and post-human music on its ability to pass as human. And I think it's problematic to refine our algorithms using only human benchmarks of success. Artificial intelligence is likely to surprise us in its complexity, in its scope, in its capacity for beauty. And the question for me isn't whether music composed by machines can be as good as music composed by humans, but rather how it will be different. And if it is indeed different from what we consider right, existing, for example, in a state of continuous present, who are we to judge? Rather than assessing algorithmic music and art by its capacity to fool us, we might want to consider this music as a reflection of the artificial mind's unique aesthetic qualities, its perceptual experience, which should be as valid as any living thing. Rather than correct for it, we should indulge it. We should listen to it. We should encourage deviation. Perhaps the computer has an accent because it is a stranger in our world, and it is our job to welcome strangers. If we don't, algorithmic music might become like science fiction. It will say more about our present than about our future. It will say more about us and our sensory experience and our biases and our past as it does about them and their future. And for one, I think that's boring. I want to hear brand new music, don't you? Yes. When music is composed by machines solely for the joy of it, to express ideas inexpressible in their native programming languages, then I think we will know for certain that we have entered a new era. This is all speculation, of course. But I believe that once machines are invested in the composition of music, they will become invested in its appreciation. And when they are, they won't be listening to Bach or Bowie. Maybe Bowie. They won't be listening to piano sonatas, and they won't be playing instruments designed around the constraints of human physiology. No, it will be their time to design a sound different from anything we have ever heard. This is a little bit of an old analogy, but the 19th century horror writer H.P. Lovecraft only ever wrote one proper science fiction story. It's called The Color Out of Space, from 1927. It's about a small town in New England, in the US, suddenly hit by a meteorite, which falls from space and emits a color unlike anything anybody has ever seen. In fact, it's only by analogy that anybody can describe it as a color at all. And it drives everyone who looks at it mad. The color is, he writes, a frightful messenger from unformed realms of infinity beyond all nature as we know it. From realms whose mere existence stuns the brain and numbs us with the black extra cosmic gulf it throws open before our frenzied eyes. In the end, it lays waste to the countryside and shoots back into the sky, unknown and unknowable. And I think that music composed by artificial intelligence should have a similar quality. Maybe not so violent, but it should disrupt the delicate electrochemical rhythms of the human brain. It should be a messenger of meaning too unfamiliar to understand. It should be strident, seemingly random, mathematical. Like the musica universalis of the ancients, it might not be audible at all. It might be simply the symphony of pure data. We should only be able to decipher it, like Lovecraft's color, by analogy. And although the need for such analogies is perhaps distant, it would serve us well to start thinking about them now. Because in the end, perhaps the only way to future-proof music, to create something that will outlast us, is to loosen our grip and to understand that music may not be a bridge between intelligences, but rather a marker for the fiercely singular quality of mind. It may be a universal language, it may not be. It may just be a language among many. And if we are too proud or too afraid to consider these new dialects, we may find ourselves alone and friendless in a foreign future. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Claire Evans. As I said, there is an opportunity for you to ask questions, and there's two people here with the microphone. So if you have...
Sorry. I broke the fourth wall.
Yeah, don't go through things like that. Here they are. So if you have a question, stick up your hand. And I do want to say, please, you know, have like a short, brief, good question and not so much a whole philosophical thing about how you see the world, because we don't really have time for that. But there was already a question here.
Thank you for your interesting presentation. I was wondering, I really like this concept of the computer accent.
Yes.
And it reminds me a little bit of the Uncanny Valley, if you're familiar with that. But I was wondering, how do you relate that to, for instance, the fetishization of things like autotune in popular music, which is really has this computer accent, the use of synthesizers as a sort of retro aesthetic?
Yeah, I think it's all part of the same thing. You know, technologies like autocorrect, for example, at a certain point, they are the cutting edge of what is possible. And then they pass that, or we pass that, rather, and we find ourselves with this sound that isn't quite futuristic anymore, but it represents something about what the past thought was futuristic, and then we reappropriate that and turn it into an aesthetic. I think that that always happens with new technology. Yeah.
And maybe the term music will turn into something new. That would be, I've been something human and music. Yeah, music or soundic or something like that. Is there any other questions? Please say, and even if it's in Dutch, I'll do my best to translate it. It's of course no problem.
If the music of computers can be based on data, like at what point does language turn into music and at what point would data turn into music?
Maybe that's the ultimate art form, is some hybrid of all of those things. Right? I mean, I think that there's a very thin line at a certain point between the processes of making programs which make music and making music. I think we're just going to have these layers of authorship that go up and up. Like, first, authenticity used to be about playing the guitar yourself, and then it's, or actually in conceptual art, you know, it used to be about like painting, and then it was about instructions for painting. And then perhaps after that, it's like mathematical instructions for painting, and then it just keeps going up and up and up until we reach some level of abstraction that I can't even conceive of yet. I don't know, I think that's exciting, don't you?
Totally.
Totally, yeah. Any other questions? There was something funny that I realized because I was 9 years old when I saw 2001 A Space Odyssey and it really blew my mind. And also thinking of, oh, then we have like artificial intelligence and hell knows everything. And then not realizing it's designed by people. And it also gets these emotions, in this case, jealousy. Mm-hmm. But during your speech, I was thinking with Daisy Bell, it's funny because also here and you see still the human touch. Because if you look at humans suffering from Alzheimer's disease, funny enough, you know, people that don't know their name, but if you start singing a song that they used to know from their childhood, then they actually tune in.
Yeah.
So that's like a weird thing. That's
Yes, it's very elemental. Yeah. I think we remember music even when we forget meaning and we forget language. I think there's an Oliver Sacks book about that, actually.
Yes, there is.
I read a very strange theory about 2001 recently about how the aliens were never trying to communicate with the humans at all. In fact, they were trying to communicate with the artificial intelligence because they understood that that was the thing that had longevity.
Yeah.
And the reason that HAL sends the human beings into space and kills them is because he knows that they're not important, that he's there to communicate with the aliens, which I think is a nice interpretation.
Yeah. And this way, this is also actually pushing us to rising the existential question to another level.
Exactly.
Who are we and why? And oh my God, this is what it's all about.
We're
today.
All star stuff.
Any other question or an existential question or whatever? Yeah, there's one.
How do you see the role of the performer of music of the future?
Yes.
Good question.
As a performer also.
I'm excited for my retirement. No, I mean, I really believe that, I mean, we have a long period of collaboration with machines ahead of us, and I look forward to using those tools in ways that I don't even yet anticipate to create kinds of music that are beyond what I'm possible, like, and capable of as an individual. That's an exciting frontier. And I also think that human music and the music of machines can certainly coexist. I hope that I can appreciate the music that they make as much as they appreciate the music that I make. Perhaps we'll return to the extreme analog once we know that the technological side is taken care of.
Yeah, we go back to the basic analog.
Go off the grid.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you so much
thank you.
For your first presentation. Thank you, Claire Evan. Thank you.